Welcome to the Clinton Township Planning Commission meeting for Thursday, January 9th. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Secretary, roll call, please.
Mr. Aragona.
Here.
Mr. Brumbaugh.
Excused.
Ms. Cherry, present. Mr. Kurd.
Present.
Mr. DeBartolomeo.
Present.
Ms. Mosley.
Here.
Mr. Opaleski.
Here.
Mr. Spatafora.
Present.
And Ms. Trombley.
Here.
Also in attendance tonight, we have the Township Planner, Bruce Thompson.
Thank you. Item number one is the approval of the agenda. Are there any additions or deletions? If there are none, is there a motion?
I'll so move to approve.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Spatafora.
Yes.
Mr. Opaleski.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Ms. Cherry, yes. Mr. Kurd.
Yes.
Mr. DeBartolomeo.
Yes.
Ms. Mosley.
Yes.
And Ms. Trombley.
Yes.
Thank you. Item number two was 1.493 acres of land fronting the east side of North Gratiot, south of Barbret, addressed as 43920 North Gratiot Avenue. This is a revised site development for U-Haul of Clinton Township, the sales office addition. Madam Secretary, is there correspondence?
Madam Chair, there were 28 notices mailed and one returned with no correspondence.
Thank you. Mr. Thompson?
Thank you very much. If I can just call everybody's attention to the screen, I have a couple images that show the overall site. This is a site that has multiple properties. In this particular case, the parcel that we're talking about and the building that we're talking about is the one that you see in the forefront of this image. The addition is to that existing building that you see there on the left. This is another view to the west, so you see that same building. That's the north side of the building. That's where that addition is going to go. Further to the north, commercial strip center use. This is the additional U-Haul site to the south. It's predominantly mini storage, and then there's some truck storage as well. And then further to the south, the Moran Collision Shop. Looking through the site, property to the east is Mobile Home Park, and then to the west, various commercial uses on the west side of Gratiot. So this is a copy of the plan that was submitted by the petitioner. So you saw that building in the first two images. This is that building here, and what they're talking about is an addition to the north side of that building a building that will be 1,364 square feet. It will be constructed of the same material as this existing building, so you'll have a consistent look, which is consistent throughout the entire development as well. The building will be constructed at just a little under 16 feet. There are 31 parking spaces that will remain. Parking is being reoriented a little bit, and so are some of the driveways. But ultimately, the plan that you have exceeds minimum standards for parking, has appropriate access. Fire department's reviewed it. Everybody's taken a look at it. And so the site is adequate in the aspects of parking and access through and in and off the site. Landscaping already exists along the street side of the site. This isn't that old of a site-planned property, and so the site's still in basic conformance with the ordinance and the approved plan back when it was originally approved. All the other information required, site lighting, site signage, dumpster enclosures, loading spaces, all that information is part of this plan and meets ordinance requirements. Therefore, approval is recommended. Thank you.
Thank you. The petitioner is present for this matter.
Yes, I am.
If you could, sir, state your name and address for the record, please.
Clarence Vicent, 43920 North Gratiot Avenue.
Thank you. Do you have anything you'd like to add to this matter?
No, just looking for approval for additional expansion of our showroom.
Okay. All right. Any questions or comments from the commissioners at this time? Any questions or comments from anyone in the audience at this time? If there are no questions or comments, is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Kurd.
Yes.
Mr. Spatafora.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Ms. Cherry, yes. Mr. DeBartolomeo.
Yes.
Ms. Mosley.
Yes.
Mr. Opaleski.
Yes.
And Ms. Trombley.
Yes.
Thank you. The motion passes, and because this is a revised site development plan, this does not need to go before the board. Thank you. You're all set.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Happy New Year.
Have a good night. Thank you. Item number three is consideration of MKSK proposal for the Groesbeck Highway Market Study and Corridor Plan. This is a request for recommendation to the Township Board. Madam Secretary, is there correspondence? Nope.
No, there's no correspondence.
Mr. Thompson?
Thank you very much. I'm very excited tonight to bring this to you. This is one of the main reasons when I interviewed for the position of planning director that I was brought on board is to start working with the Planning Commission, working with the Township Board in this community at putting together a plan for the redevelopment of the Groesbeck Corridor. The Planning Department, as a result, at the beginning of October, put out an RFP, a request for proposals, to planning firms and looking at proposals for this study. The study I was looking for was kind of a dual purpose. One, providing a basic market plan so that we know what's out there, right? You can't know where you're going if you don't know what you've got, right? And then two, to come up with a set of site development guidelines, something that both the Planning Commission, the Township Board, and in some cases, maybe even the Zoning Board, if they have to, can all look at and say, this is how we want buildings and sites on the Groesbeck Corridor to start looking. We're going to raise the bar. We're going to create some very special standards and guidelines that we will apply to the Groesbeck Corridor. And the reason they're in front of, or Brad is here tonight, is in front of you, and this is coming to you, is what my goal was when we all updated the master plan. You recall, we created a very special zoning or master plan designation for Groesbeck as a redevelopment corridor. So that's part of the plan was to designate that area specifically and then move ahead and start creating site development guidelines and start focusing on Groesbeck and making it look better and making it look different, giving it some character. Whatever we all decide on, right? I mean, that's the whole point of this is appointed officials and elected officials and community and the business owners out there getting together and saying, what do we want this to look like? What do we want it to look like 5 years from now, 10 years from now, and all of that? So on the 25th of October, we did have proposals submitted. There were actually three. They were reviewed by myself and by my assistant planner, Matt Wallace, and MKSK obviously rose to the top. So what we're asking tonight is for you to consider that. I gave you a copy of the relevant portions of the plan that I felt that you should be looking at, and we're just asking you to recommend approval of MKSK to the Township Board. They would ultimately approve them as the consultant and approve the contract. Mm-hmm. Some of you will be involved as potentially part of the committee that we're going to put together, but ultimately it will be an amendment to the master plan, so things will end up back here in general. They'll be working with us, if you approve them, to go through that process as well. If you have any questions, certainly Brad Strader is the principal for MKSK. I've asked him to be here tonight in case you had any questions. Again, I know I gave you a certain amount of information. I do have their proposal in digital form available if you have any questions or if Brad wants to point anything out in that respect.
Okay. Thank you. Brad, you want to step up?
Sure. Brad Strader, principal from MKSK. We're in Midtown Detroit. I run that office, and kind of one of our specialties is corridor plans and corridor redevelopment, so I think that's one of the reasons we've been recommended by staff working on this. And
Brad, speak into the mic for us, please.
I've walked and driven the corridor, so we threw in our proposal a lot of the ideas we have based on the request for proposal to first look at market, what's the market potential. Part of that will be from looking at numbers. So on the team we have Sharon Woods from Land Use USA is one of the top market analysts for this type of work in the state of Michigan. We've worked with her on probably a dozen other corridor projects around the state of Michigan. So she'd kind of look at statistics and look at what's happened in the last few years, trends, and what the market is for different types of uses. But then also some of her work is just through discussions with property owners and brokers. So she's got interviews set up and kind of give a market snapshot. So as Bruce said, we can look at what is the market potential. Is it more industrial, office type uses, what types of commercial we can accommodate, and that will help us decide what the land use plan would be and changes. And then the real focus is on design guidelines. And once we know the uses, have a set of design guidelines for architecture, signs, lighting, landscaping, pedestrian circulation, just very good site design. And on this corridor for Groesbeck, we'd have to look at both when there's new development, you know, a tear down and rebuild on a site or some of the large parking lots that might be redeveloped, but also what's a reasonable expectation for a redesign or upgrade when there's a change of use or an expansion? Because on this corridor, that's largely what you have, and it's going to have to be flexible. So we do have, that's why I think Bruce and the township is looking at putting a working group together that includes planning commission board members, also design professionals from the area, and some business representatives, so we can come up with something that kind of balances what you'd like to see happen out there with what's realistic in terms of the market and competing with other corridors. Just a little bit of my background. So I've probably done 70 or 80 corridor plans in Michigan and about a dozen other states. And in the past, I've met a couple of you actually in the past because I worked on the Gratiot Avenue Access Management Plan with SEMCOG and MDOT years ago with the 9 communities in Macomb County. Worked with the Macomb County Roads Department on their roads master plan. I'm currently working on the Mound Road redesign. I'm an ongoing advisor in transportation to Shelby Township and the Michigan Economic Development Corp, and a lot of other things that are in the proposal. So we do come to you with a lot of experience. Also on our project team will be Anne Marie Kirby, who's our project manager, who's a planner and does a lot of code work. And so one of the things the township wanted is to make sure when we have design guidelines, we're thinking of advance of how that gets translated into the zoning ordinance. So that'll be part of her role. And then we have a couple of our landscape architects who will really focus on landscaping, and they do all the graphics that go in the site design guidelines. So just wanted to give a quick introduction and happy to answer any questions you have about the project or the approach or our firm's experience.
Thank you. Questions or comments from the commissioners? Mr. Aragona?
Yeah, thank you for being here, Brad. I was wondering if you could go into, in the proposal under the overall work plan, it looks like you have 5 different stages, and the 5th is just the adoption of the plan, but it looks like each one of those stages is going to take about a month's time. Can you kind of delve into that a little bit and tell us what we're going to be expecting from each one of those stages?
Yeah, so the first stage is sort of a startup and kickoff. Kind of refer to the proposal here. We did put a little, I don't know if that's in your packet, but a proposal at a glance.
Yeah.
So the first is sort of the project kickoff where we gather the data. We're going to tour the corridor either with the township staff or with some representatives of the working committee, kind of organizing the working committee, putting together a survey and kind of agreeing on the engagement. When are the meetings going to be? Who are we going to invite? Who's on the working group? What people do we want to interview that aren't on the working group setting? So it's kind of getting things ready, kind of preparation. And then the second phase, we call it corridor understanding, but that's really evaluating the data that we've collected. And a lot of that work will be discussions of some of the property owners, but also the market snapshot of what the market is in terms of uses and kind of will be feeding that into the third phase. The third phase is sort of looking at alternative land uses and design guidelines. So it might be, here's some examples that the working group, and part of this would be a partnership with township staff. So it might be Bruce coming to the planning commission saying, here's what MKSK's team has put together. Here's some different images. The working group's working on this, but maybe the planning commission wants to weigh in. And that might be, here's different images. Here's the different format for design guidelines. Here's choices that you have to make in terms of how much landscaping, what are the priorities, what do you want as the threshold for when some of these kick in. So it'd be kind of concepts that would be generally the 3rd or 4th month, and then the 4th month would be kind of making the decisions on those alternatives, what the format looks like, what the priorities are, and sort of a draft plan. And then the last part is that always a bit of an unknown is we'll have a draft plan. The goal is to have a draft plan actually maybe as early as May 1st, because I know the township wants to kind of move this relatively quickly, get it through in the spring, and then starts the adoption process. And I don't know if you're familiar with that from your master plan, but that can take a while. It goes to the planning commission to feel comfortable, the full planning commission feels comfortable with the draft. You send it to the board to start the public review process, and that's a 62-day period of public review. At the end of the public review, then the planning commission has a public hearing. So that last part takes a while to get through the adoption. There might be some refinements, but the goal is sometime May to have a draft plan and be ready to start that process.
Okay. It sounded like he was kind of mentioning during step 3 that we would get an update. If that's possible, I'd appreciate that.
Through the chair, absolutely. I will update the planning commission and the township board every step of the way.
Okay.
No question.
Yeah, I should have mentioned when Bruce asked me, could we get briefings, and we'd work together, we'd prepare material. So if it's not one of the meetings we're at in our scope of work, Bruce could give you an update and say, hey, at the agenda, here's just a quick 5 minutes, just a quick briefing of where they are. If you're not on the working group, and you can give some input or at least know what's going on. Because we don't want any surprises at the end. Comes to the commission and you say, well, I wasn't on the working group, but I don't know why they did this, or why did you, I don't agree with this, you should have done this. The goal is to work with Bruce and all of you, so when it come to you to move it up to the board to start the public process, do you feel that you've been very involved, even if you weren't on the working group?
Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. Mr. Spadafora?
Yeah, hi, Brad. Thanks for coming this evening. I noticed on the page, in our copy, page 28, you have a market analysis for additional option tasks that are laid out in bullets. From your experience and maybe what you've seen here in Clinton Township, can you give maybe an example of a bullet or two that a community most frequently would, you know, engage in for additional options that would require the additional fee?
Yeah, so there are a couple of examples. I was actually meeting with the mayor of Romulus and Wayne County's new economic development director today on just that, because we do ongoing work for Romulus, and they're trying to bring certain uses to the downtown. And so one of the other aspects that a market firm could do is help put together promotional materials on specific sites, even if they're privately owned. So sometimes it can be, here's just information on what sets Clinton Township apart from other townships, or what are we looking for on Groesbeck in language that brokers or people that are maybe not familiar with the township or the corridor specifically would have that information. It could be something that the MEDC would make available, or that the County Economic Development Organization would make available. So that would be one thing, is just promotional pieces. We're also doing that for the City of Monroe, where Bruce actually worked long ago, and I've worked with Monroe ever since Bruce used to be there. And we did a corridor plan in Monroe, and then we did a redevelopment plan for the former Lazy Boy headquarters back in the fall. And just this week, the city's now hired us to help guide that developer through the PUD approval process and to do additional drawings for him. And part of this happened because they used the same market firm, Land Use USA, Sherwin Woods, put together information to interest businesses both along the corridor to stay there and reinvest, but also what's available along the Telegraph Road corridor in Monroe. And so actually a broker in Wyandotte saw that, gave it to somebody looking for a place to invest, and that's how it came about. So we would work partly way when we get through it, and we have some alternatives. That could be Sharon Woods could come and say, here's some additional things you could do. And it could be promotional pieces. It could be additional meetings with stakeholders. She's also done a lot of, if you looked at her resume, a lot of recruitment. She's worked with businesses, so she can go out and help recruit businesses and bring them here. But you don't want to do that until you know what are we trying to attract here.
Well, one of my questions was answered. This Sharon that was referred to, no last name, in the report that the commission got, I think you named that Sharon Woods,
Sharon
from
Woods, yep.
Land Use USA.
Yeah.
Okay. We did not get a resume or a CV or anything like that on her. I'm sure it can be furnished later on. The one final question, this is to Bruce. On your letter to the Planning Commission, you indicated that the design guidelines would be approved as an amendment to the master plan. What about the market study? Would that at least be mentioned in the master plan as a separate document?
Yes, it was not my intent to have it as part of the master plan, because obviously marketing and marketing plans change quickly and change regularly. So yes, there would certainly be reference to it. And then, you know, that is something, again, that this township can do in the future. As things are progressing, they may want to re-look at doing another market study and see, have they been successful? Do we need to go into another direction? And so keeping it separate from the master plan, I think, is an important part of this.
So it would be like entitled M97 Groesbeck Highway Market Study as dated such and such 2020 or mm-hmm. reference. Okay, thank you.
And just so you know, too, just to add to what Brad is saying, that firm, Land Use USA, she was actually in two of the three proposals. So there are other firms that are hot at using this firm and their expertise. And I think that speaks a lot to her resume and to the abilities of that firm.
So generally, planners like yourself and consultants like that would subcontract with Land Use USA for their specific expertise that goes in such a corridor plan study like this?
Yes, and just as Bruce said, just a couple of lessons learned over the years is when there's a market study, you want it to be separate. Sometimes it's detailed and a lot in it. It's a little complicated also if the market changes so rapidly, and I've seen other communities that included the whole market study in their master plan, and then it can be used against you when it's 4 years later and a developer wants to do something you don't want, and they said, well, your whole plan is based on a market study, and they show you new statistics, so it's better just to reference it and keep it fresh. Yep. But, so the thought we had is to just do a market snapshot. It might be, think of it as an executive summary of what the market is. Here's things to think about, and that might be the document that goes into the master plans. Is based on this snapshot, we at least considered the market. A lot of times master plans don't consider the market, and you get challenged on your land use plan, so the feeling is we need something to validate what the market is, and it'll be not just statistics again, but also based on her experience plus her conversations with people on the project. And as Bruce said, she's pretty high demand. As soon as the RFP came out, I called Sharon right away, and then 3 or 4 days later, she said she'd been contacted by 5 firms, but she had committed to us, so.
Thank you.
Ms. Cherry.
Hi, thanks for coming. So 2 questions for you. One is, it sounds like you've done lots of this stuff. So in your experience, can you talk a little bit about what cities can do to help this process be successful or hinder it in your experience? And then the second question is, in terms of practical results that a community can anticipate from this kind of process, I don't know if you have in your head a map of, well, a quarter of all the communities followed up and a quarter of them have great success, you know. So if you could talk a little bit about how you think in terms of what are realistic results that a community can realize and how often does that happen?
Sure. Well, let me try to answer and then you can follow up because that's a big, broad question, yeah. I guess. So part of it is sort of looking at case studies and experience. So that's one of the things I think we draw upon. And so what's worked well with other communities, I think design guidelines work well and being flexible in design guidelines, I think that would be a lesson learned. And having reasonable expectations for redevelopment of sites. So if you had, let's say your parking landscape requirement is 1 tree per every 10 parking spaces, and right now you've got a big parking lot with none and they want to come in and do something, and you say, well, now you've got to put in 600 trees before you can do anything. So and some communities have done that, and then they wonder why they don't get redevelopment. So you have to almost have one set of standards for a total rebuild or a major project and something that's more reasonable for the small mom and pop or just an expansion or change of use. So that would be another lesson learned. I think another is that and this is why I think Sharon Woods is valuable, you have to have realistic expectations, because I've seen some projects that have these, and I maybe worked on a couple of them too in the past, but beautiful renderings of what's going to happen out there. And here's transit and 3-story buildings and everything else. And 10 years later, nothing happened because they didn't understand the market or they overshot it. Or it's great to have great expectations, but that wasn't realistic. And so Sharon's very pragmatic, and we want to be, you know, you may have ideas of what you'd like to see here, but she may say, well, that type of development is going to go to Gratiot, or that type of development is going to Shelby, or that's going somewhere else in Clinton Township. We want to be practical. So I think having realistic understanding of what it can be is another lesson learned. And sometimes when you, like Troy was very bold on redoing Big Beaver, and they had a big vision and they met it. So it's possible. But some communities have a big vision that isn't realistic for their market or the uses that are out there. So I think that would be a major lesson. And although it's not a focus of this, we did include a meeting with MDOT and their TSC, because a lot of the impression people have of Groesbeck is in the MDOT right-of-way. So we wanted to at least have some conversations with MDOT about like closing driveways and sidewalks and getting people across the road, or lighting or landscaping in the right-of-way. And I think some of the corridor plans I've seen don't involve the road agency, and we think that that's important to do. So that'd be a few lessons. So.
Thank you.
You good, Ms. Sherry?
I think so.
Okay. Mr. Hurd?
Thank you.
Brad, appreciate your time. How long has your firm been in business?
MKSK, I think 30 years.
And I'm gonna guess that I might know the answer to this, but do you have any local corridors where you would say, hey, this is a home run, this is the best implementation? You mentioned Troy and Big Beaver. You know, are there others outside of that where you would say, hey, go drive this corridor, this is a vision that really came together?
Bits and pieces. Groesbeck's a little different than a lot because of the industrial. One I would say would be, and I've done two corridor plans for them, would be State Road in Pittsfield Township south of Ann Arbor. But that was more new development and not as much redevelopment. For some of the redevelopment, I've worked on Orchard Lake Road corridor plan that has some industrial, some commercial, and it took, maybe that's another lesson learned, is change doesn't happen overnight, and you got to be persistent, and sometimes the change takes about 20 years.
Mm.
So you might see some changes here and there, but it might be 10, 20 years, and you drive it and see changes, so it's not going to happen that quickly. That would be a couple, let's see, Grand River, a couple different parts of Grand River I've worked on in Novi and Genoa Township between Brighton and Howell. I think those are both corridors that I've been involved in. Like, they've brought me back multiple times to refresh and update the plan to adjust to conditions. Several corridors in Grand Blanc Township. Some were redevelopment corridors, some were new development corridors. I've got, those are probably the, and then several in the Grand Rapids area. I've done a lot of work in Kalamazoo and Grand Rapids, but like the East Beltline, if you know Grand Rapids, out by the Grand Rapids Airport, Cascade Township, City of Kentwood, Gaines Township. Some of that is new, like new Amazon facilities, and other was kind of like this corridor as small commercial, mom and pop, next to franchises, next to an industrial, next to a warehouse, next to an auto shop, next to a gas station. So that kind of this different hybrid of uses. That would be another example. I guess little bits and pieces. Well, when we're doing our sort of impressions of what the corridor could look like, you'll see some of the corridors we've worked on and then other ones that we haven't worked on, but we think are good case studies as well. So,
great. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kurd. Any other questions or comments from the commissioners? Questions or comments from the public?
Yes, I'm wondering if you can tell me the value of this plan when we have a couple of...
Well, I'm sorry, can you first state your name and address
sure
for the
can.
Record?
Sam Bushell, 18546 Wayland Drive, Clinton
All right,
Township.
All right, Mr. Bushell.
Mm-hmm. We have... There's Major Magic, which is entertainment. It's coming into what was a closed restaurant that never had entertainment. It has, it's not even going to the site plan. The building department and the planner decided it shouldn't come to the site plan. It's not being brought up to date. It's a major item on Groesbeck. Then you have the old Duncan property. It actually has exterior additions put onto it and everything else that they're building on right now. There again, the building department and the planner decided it shouldn't come to the planning commission. It's not being updated. Forget about any landscaping or lighting. And then you have Velic Transportation, which is across the street from the Duncan right on Groesbeck. It literally hasn't gone to the ZBA, but it already has. If you go look at there, they're doing all kinds of development work, even though they haven't gone to the ZBA, and they're asking for some major, major variances from the ZBA. Should the ZBA, is this plan... If, as you're working on it, the township is approving stuff like this without them doing any improvement to the area, is your plan worth the money? If they're not going to follow, and obviously they're not following it now, and they keep saying they're going to try to improve. There can the township board, a couple years ago, they approved a temporary land use for a new trucking firm with just a gravel lot and fence and not one bush. It's still in business now, and it's never even been taxed. And this is Pahoa Express. And so if there's no follow-through, if the planning commission, it's not the planning commission's fault because they aren't even getting these properties to them. I would say it is definitely the problem of the building department, the planner, and the township board because they're aware of all this going on. And when you have a total, with Major Magic, but this thing, you can drive by it, it's going to change your plan because it looks very ugly in the brown color they've painted it. I just heard you talking about the sign. They have a horrible sign up there. Not one bush, not one tree, not one light, nothing. But it's been approved already by the township board and this planning commission. They aren't even getting a chance to look at it. Will this plan work if that's the township board's, if this is just maybe a political thing to say, gee, for the election, we want to have a plan in place?
Mr. Bushell, I'm not sure I understand the question. Brad, can you answer?
If there's no follow through, in effect, there's active.
So I think maybe some of the specifics I can't answer, but generally for one of the reasons you do a plan is to implement the plan. And so you already brought up some good questions about, in the dialogue we've had tonight. So first you want to grant the vision of what's reasonable and have those standards, and then to implement it, some of it will be through ordinance. So we would be looking at some point of looking at the ordinance, what goes into the zoning, because the zoning ordinance becomes a regulatory law or practice in the township. And part of that that we would look at with you is what are the thresholds when these site upgrades happen. So I don't know the specifics here, but as an example of how much or what upgrades do you have on a site when it goes through. So some communities say, we're so happy to get a reoccupancy that there is no upgrades. Others expect a full upgrade, and sometimes that discourages development, maybe you wait till you get what you want, or you look at, well, maybe each site has to be a little, some of the ordinance work, and it could be in the plan, gives a menu. And in these kind of situations, maybe at least look for frontage landscaping, or these kind of situations, look at closing one of the three driveways. So there could be a menu of things. But the idea is that there's a reasonable upgrade of sites when there's reoccupancy or redevelopment, but there is some level of upgrade, but not in every case. There may be some cases where, but your guidance would tell you that, where you don't need to do it. And what's a staff approval versus goes to the Planning Commissioner Board, that would be more in the ordinance, not in the plan. So that's maybe the best answer I can give at this point.
Thank you, Brad.
Then my follow-up question would be, if the township, there again, the township is requiring some of these properties, and they're again not necessarily on Groesbeck, to come to site plan for revision, and not the ones on Groesbeck. In other words, they're picking and choosing how they follow the law. Is that a potential problem for legal ramifications to the township?
Mr. Thompson.
Thank you. Mr. Bushell, I'm just going to kind of answer your concerns or questions or whatever you want to call them very succinctly. We are following the ordinances of this township. As the planning director of this community, I was brought on to ensure that the ordinances of this township are followed with respect to site plan, with respect to anything that is within that book. You are making assumptions. We've tried to have these discussions with you about what does the ordinance say, what is required. I resent some of the things you're saying, and accusing me of not following the ordinance, and accusing, I'm speaking, sir.
Mm-hmm.
And that is absolutely not true. Because you may feel that way, you certainly are entitled to your opinion. But I am here to tell you, we are applying the ordinances properly. That is our duty. And we will continue to apply the ordinances properly. If a site is being redeveloped and it meets the criteria in the ordinance to be brought to the Planning Commission for site plan approval, that is what we will do. If it does not, then we will not. I am not going to arbitrarily force a site that is undergoing building renovations to go through site plan approval when the ordinance does not require it. And that's really what you're insinuating. I'm not done, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. I would welcome you to come in and sit down and we can talk about this. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Just as I've said before. But, you know, to try and challenge the professionalism of myself and my colleagues because you feel something should be one way versus another, I don't think that's fair. I guess that's where I'll stop.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
And there again, I've got emails there again, even from Mr. Thompson, where if the footprint of the building changes, it has to go to site plan. At the Duncan property, please drive by there and you'll see that there's an addition going on right now, and it's not coming before you. The other times, I've got other emails from the township saying, well, interior reservation changes don't have to come to the Planning Commission, but exterior provisions do.
No.
And now it's a matter, now the latest thing this week, and I've got emails that I can provide to any of you if you want them, where now it says, interior, exterior doesn't matter. It all goes. And that's what I'm saying. If the township is paying a bunch of money for a study and a plan that they're not going to follow, it's money wasted. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bushell. Any other questions or comments from the commissioners at this time? If there are no other questions or comments, is there a motion?
So moved.
Support.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Ms. Trombley.
Yes.
Ms. Cherry. Yes. Mr. Kurd.
Yes.
Mr. DeBartolomeo.
Yes.
Ms. Mosley.
Yes.
Mr. Opaleski.
Yes.
And Mr. Spadafora.
Yes.
Thank you. The motion passes. Okay, Bruce, so this is going to go to the Township Board.
Yes.
For their final consideration.
Yes, I've been working with this Township Attorney's Office at formulating a contract based on this proposal. We are looking at placing it on the next Township Board meeting Once we do that, Brad and his folks and I will get together and we'll hold that kind of first initial meeting, probably tour the corridor together, and then set up a game plan and just hit the ground running. And as Brad had indicated, really our goal is to get it done quicker than what you see, Mr. Aragona, in that timeline. You know, we are doing the strategic planning process right now, and I really would like to kind of time them together if I could, at least to the point where Brad had indicated, where we at least get through the plan. We can always do the amendment, you know, subsequently, but I kind of like them to keep moving together, if you will, because obviously there's a lot of feedback with respect to economic development in that strategic planning process. So that's the goal.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Brad. We appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, item number four is the proposed revision to the Planning Commission Rules of Procedure. This is a request for approval of amended Planning Commission Rules of Procedure, and this was postponed from our December 12th meeting. Madam Secretary?
No.
No correspondence? Bruce? I'm sorry.
It's okay. There's no correspondence,
Thank
Madam
you.
Chair.
Bruce?
What? The secretary was referring to is Mr. Brumbaugh was not able to make it today, and he did send me an email, and I gave you a copy of that email. He did review the documents, and he wanted to at least get something in writing to you all to at least let you understand some of the changes he thought that might be made. And there were actually three of them. One was a change to tonight's agenda, because we had discussed, even though it's not part of your rules yet, to start including it on the agenda, and unfortunately we did not do that, and so I wanted to get a revised agenda so that public comments start now, because it is something that we should have on there. The second was some concern he had about this evening we have the election of officers, but in the bylaws it actually shows that they're supposed to occur in December. So it's something obviously he felt needed to be cleared up, and I agree. Are we, you know, let's make sure we're all on the same page. Mm-hmm. We're all happy with the fact that they're in January or they're in December or whenever you want them to be. Obviously, consistency with what you've done in the past is important, but something to discuss. The last is it actually refers to a different location for the meetings to be held. So obviously, that's something that needs to be updated. I don't think that's something that needs to be debated, but mm-hmm. certainly we'll make that change to this document after we have our discussion this evening. Otherwise, I made the changes that we had discussed. What you're looking at is both pages 5 and 6, and I'm sorry, 5, 6, and 7. 5 under section 302, update your normal order of business to include public comments after the agenda items and before report of meeting. Mm-hmm. Then under section 304, what I did was really look at the Township Board's recent amendments to their policies regarding public comment. And so it's kind of a pared down version, because you wouldn't do some of the things that they do. Mm-hmm. But if you've had a chance to read through them, I think they're pretty straightforward. I know there was some question about, do you want 2 minutes or 3 minutes? I left it at 3. Obviously, you know, that's going to be something that you all are going to have to decide. But those are the changes that I've made after our last meeting. So I guess I would open up to the commission for whatever discussion you want to have.
All right. Questions or comments?
I do have a comment.
Okay, go ahead.
I was looking at number 3 under section 304, number 3, comments by person should be confined. I'd like to see must, because I'm just, and I was reading our minutes from our last meeting where people can go far afield and not sticking to Planning Commission items. And I think the word must kind of really narrows it in and hones it in. I'd like to see that change. Also on number 5 on page 7, where it says specific questions raised by persons at public comments section that cannot be reasonably answered by commission shall be referred. I'm hoping that would mean after the meeting in response as opposed to a question and answer. I know we did have discussion here and we felt question and answer session is not appropriate at our meetings, and I'm hoping that that's what this means here, is that a response would come later in time after the meeting.
Okay.
Am I correct on that?
Yes.
Okay. Those were my two comments.
Okay, so are you okay with that language, or do we need to change anything so that it's absolutely clear?
Again, I'd like to see the word must as opposed to should.
Mm-hmm.
And on number 5, I don't know if it kind of opens the door and doesn't really hone in what we're looking at, if there's some verbiage that can be there that...
Maybe at the end of, Ron, at the end of that sentence, number five, you know, you can, after the word response, remove the period and put at a later date or some future date.
That's fine.
If necessary.
If necessary.
If necessary, yes.
Okay.
That would be fine with me.
Okay. That makes it clear cut, sure. No assumptions.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Duly noted.
Any other questions, comments?
Madam Chair.
Mr. Kurt.
Following up on number five, as I read it, specific questions raised by persons of comments at the public comment session, that cannot be reasonably answered. It sort of leaves that door open to that there is an expectation of an answer. And so if it is a comment where the public is welcome to comment, we receive those comments, I would strike the idea of reasonably answering. Mm-hmm. We can put something that says, we'll take it under advisement, we'll respond, you know, we'll review and respond if necessary after the meeting, but I would... That reasonably answer, I think, I read that and I think, if I'm coming to the commission, I'm asking a question, mm-hmm. my question is reasonable, how come you're not answering me?
Mm-hmm.
Over and against, I'm here to give a comment, I want you to have some information from me, if it merits a response. Mm-hmm. I guess that's the kind of, if it merits a response, we should be in control of that response mm-hmm. and not in the 3-minute back and forth.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's my thought.
That's a good point.
That's how I read that as well. I agree.
Any other questions, comments? All right.
Just Bruce, for your background, maybe you already know this, but at one time this building was the 41A district
right.
court before they built the
yep.
new one. So
yep.
you were saying that before, just before the new building on Starks was constructed, the new courthouse.
Okay.
That's why it's
I kind of
township
knew that.
Board
yeah.
chambers.
Okay, yeah, we want to make it clear, though. We want to make it clear for everybody. Mr. Bushell, do you have comments?
Yes, Sam Bushell, 18546 Wayland Drive. On the public, I'm glad you're finally putting the public comments on because it is required by law from the Open Meetings Act. It has been for quite a while. And this doesn't apply to you guys, but I hope next Wednesday the ZBA will also follow suit. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Did we want to, how are we going to clarify that number five? Do you want to do that or no?
Just wait for new verbiage to come back?
You want to postpone it again or?
It's up to you. I mean, if you want to, if you want, I can certainly revise it and we could put it on the next agenda. I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah.
We're not in a big hurry, I think.
Right.
You know,
we're gonna
hold public comment because obviously
right.
it's something we need to do. And
right.
if it takes a little time to tighten up the language, I'm more than happy to
mm-hmm.
okay.
revise so, it and get it back to you.
If you want to do that,
mm-hmm.
I'll move to table in order to revise number five, but part of my motion will be to direct the planning director to include the changes made by Mr. DeBartolomeo, as well as the change to section 201, number one, referring to the month of the elections, as well as a change to section 301, number 8, and to update the name of the location of our meetings.
I'll second that wonderful motion.
Thank you.
question on the motion then, Joe. You're looking to change it from December to January then?
Correct. Yeah, and from what Mr. Brumbaugh said. Looks like in the old rules, it should have been in December. We're going to do it in January now, I believe, after this. So we'll just do that year over year.
Okay. So we're going to change it mm-hmm. to January.
Right.
Okay.
I'll still second it.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Ms. Cherry. Yes. Mr. Kurd.
Yes.
Mr. DeBartolomeo.
Yes.
Ms. Mosley.
Yes.
Mr. Opaleski.
Yes.
Mr. Spatafora.
Yes.
And Ms. Trombley.
Yes. Thank you. The motion passes. Bruce, thank you for your hard work. We appreciate you.
No problem.
Item number five is the election of the officers for 2020. Chairperson, vice chairperson, and secretary. So just as a comment, I think the way we've done this in the past is we combine. The election, unless someone wants to do it separately, you know, we can vote for chair, vice chair, and secretary, you know, as a combination instead of doing them individually. if that's what you all, you know, want to do.
I'd like to make a motion to keep our existing officers as they are, if they would all accept.
I'll support that motion.
Me too.
Okay.
I'll think it over.
Ms. Cherry?
Yeah, I'll do it.
Roll call, please.
Ms. Trombley.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Ms. Cherry, yes. Mr. Kurd.
Yes.
Mr. DeBartolomeo.
Yes.
Ms. Mosley.
Yes.
Mr. Obolensky.
Yes.
And Mr. Spafford.
Yes.
Thank you. Motion passes. Thank you, everybody. We appreciate you guys. All right. Item number six, our new item on our agenda. Item number six, public comments.
Oh, Sam Bushel, 18546 Wayland. I will definitely keep it very short. Major Magic is taking over a place.
Mr. Bushel, can you hold on a moment? I believe these public comments are supposed to be timed. Are you timing them at all?
Restart. I am timing these comments.
Okay. Mr. Bushel can go a little long. So I'm at the board now, meeting, yeah. So we want to
okay.
go from
all right.
I want to restart the timer. Basically, Major Magic has never had, it's replacing a restaurant that never had entertainment. It's now going to have a band. It's going to more be an entertainment complex than a restaurant. And every other time I've seen the township board have to give special land use for entertainment and set down guidelines for hours and such in every other case. I believe this place should have come to the Planning Commission. The other thing, as I said, Duncan, you can go by it tomorrow. Take a look. There is an addition being put onto it. It is changing the footprint of the building. And I very much feel I've got an email I can give to any of you that even Mr. Thompson said, if the footprint changes, it's got to come to the Planning Commission. And I think that's something that this, you know, it's definitely has to do with the Planning Commission. And I hope you each take the time to drive by and see that, yes, the footprint of the building is changing. And these things didn't come to you. Now, I've got other stuff, and I'm not going to say it. I'll keep it very short. Thank you,
Mr. Bushel. Okay, item number seven is the Planning Commission annual report, request for approval of the 2019 annual report. Mr. Thompson.
Thank you. Last year was the first year I did it.
Great.
What I'm trying to do is progress towards a bigger, better plan, report for you. This is actually closer to what I was doing in Westland when I was there, not just providing basic information, but you know, images, graphics, make this something that's user-friendly. Really that's it. I am going to keep it in digital form. I'm not going to start printing off copies of these things unless somebody wants them. I can certainly do so, but obviously in an effort to make Planning Commission paperless and the Township Board being so, once this is approved, it will be transmitted to the Township Board in digital form. And obviously we'll get you a final copy that doesn't say draft. But I think, you know, as you can see, the Planning Commission was very active. I think probably the biggest change that you will have seen is conditional rezonings. You were visiting a lot of conditional rezonings in the last couple few years. As your planning director, I'm more of the, I look more for compliance with ordinance and putting the proper use in the proper zone and not necessarily trying to change things through items like conditional rezonings. Now, we certainly do have the planned unit development designation. I think that really is a good substitute for something along the lines of conditional rezoning for two reasons. One, we can't propose conditional rezonings. Those come to us at a request from property owners. But a PUD, this administration can offer that up as a tool and work with developers, and so it just gives us more flexibility. And so hopefully we'll start to see those planned unit developments increase on some of these tough sites, and we'll start getting away from conditional rezoning. Certainly, if they are proposed to the planning department, a conditional rezoning, they will certainly be brought to your attention. In fact, there will be one at the next Planning Commission meeting. Just so that you know, but I'll get to that. So, but otherwise, we'll continue to stay busy. I would expect this year will probably be pretty similar in the amount of cases that you'll see. And hopefully with things like the Groesbeck plan and the strategic plan and some of the other things we're doing, we'll start to see more redevelopments occurring in the township over the next few years.
These are public?
They will be, yes.
Okay.
It is your job under the state statute to prepare this report and then approve it and transmit it to the township board. Once the township board has it, it'll be distributed to them first. Certainly, I'll give you a copy, but then absolutely, it's public information. Anybody can get a copy of it. I can email it to anybody. We can print off a copy if somebody wants it. Absolutely.
Because I think this is a, you know, really good summary.
Yes.
You know, it just summarizes everything.
And I can tell you, it's also a very good tool. I've actually already used last year's and the draft of this year's to provide information to other agencies, the county. Selfridge Air Base is doing their strategic planning process. So in compiling this information, it's actually information that others can use. So it really, really works well as a tool for all of us.
Thank you. Denise?
Well, I just want to say thank you very much. I wish for as many years as I've been on the Planning Commission, I would have loved to have this. And you've done it so well. And, you know, it's all brief, you know, very, very nicely done.
And if you see any other information, I don't mean to interrupt, but any other information you want to see in them, let me know. You know, if you're looking for more information about square footage of the buildings that were approved or something along those lines, I'm more than willing to add whatever information you feel is necessary to transmit what you're doing to the township board. Because really, this is a snapshot of you, right? And so I any kind of feedback like that is very important to me, so please do.
It's very nice. Thank you.
Go ahead, Bayer.
I would just agree with Ms. Trombley. I was very pleasantly surprised. A lot of times these things are just terribly dry and painful to get through. But I appreciated the you know, the thumbnail images that you put in there and everything. It's really a good refresher of what we've done, and you know, you can start to see trends developing from what's, it's kind of eye opening. So thank you very much.
Any other questions or comments? Mr. Kerr.
Mr. Thompson, just want to say, I think as a new member of the Planning Commission, I think you're doing yeoman's work here. And despite other comments maybe that may have called you into question, very impressed by how you operate. You've got there's a bit of a teaching component for us, and you're giving us the benefit of your knowledge, experience, wisdom, and helping us kind of drive forward. So I really appreciate the way you work. This is just an example of the good work I've seen from you so far. I'm happy to be working with you. And keep up the good work. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Mr. Bushell, do you have any comments? Okay. If not, is there a motion?
So move.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Who is that second? Okay, you ready?
Yes.
Mr. Curd?
Yes.
Mr. Obaleski?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Ms. Cherry, yes. Mr. De Bartolomeo?
Yes.
Ms. Mosley?
Yes.
Mr. Spadafora?
Yes.
And Ms. Trombley?
Yes. Thank you. Item number 8 is the report of the meeting, the approval of the December 12, 2019 report. Everyone's had a chance to review the report. Questions, comments, changes?
If no further additions, corrections, or deletions, I'll move to approve.
Support.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Spadafora.
Yes.
Ms. Trombley.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Ms. Cherry, I will abstain. I was not at that meeting. Mr. Curd.
Yes.
Mr. De Bartolomeo.
Yes.
Ms. Mosley.
Yes.
Mr. Opaleski.
Yes.
That's everybody.
Thank you. The motion passes. Bruce, item number 9, discussion on the next meeting agenda scheduled for Thursday, January 23rd.
Okay, so obviously we'll be bringing back the revision to your rules of procedure for your final review. We do have Providence Estates, the first PUD you folks have reviewed, coming back with their final plan approval. I think I might have mentioned that at the last meeting.
Who was that? I'm sorry, Ms.
Providence Estates, the residential PUD up here. They made some changes based on some of the comments they heard from the audience, and I applaud them for that and listening. I mean, that's what the whole process is for, right? Mm-hmm. Be flexible, use this PUD to do that, to make it a win-win for everybody. So I think you'll be satisfied with the plans that are coming forward. But you'll be looking at it, in essence, as a site development plan approval, like a site plan approval, everything else. So you're dotting I's, crossing T's, making sure that it meets all the requirements that you anticipate. The second thing we have is a case or a couple of cases that we reviewed back when I first started, about a year ago, for the Italian-American Cultural Center.
I had that marked, too.
Yeah. They have actually requested to amend their zoning change request to a conditional zoning. They aren't really changing what they want to do on the site, but I think what they're doing is, in offering a conditional rezoning, is responding to the concerns that some of the folks in the area had about opening the site up to other uses that might be allowed under that B3 designation. So they're still requesting the zoning change from the residential to the commercial, but it, the agreement would limit it to just expansion of their use as proposed. And so that's what they're going to be bringing forward to you. There were two cases. It was both a rezoning right. request and a site plan. Right. So we'll bring both those cases back to you. Typically, though, when you do a conditional zoning agreement, the site development plan is actually part of the conditional zoning agreement. So it might be, and I have to talk to the township attorney, that it comes back at this point as just one request for a conditional zoning agreement because the plan goes with it. But I want to make sure I do it right. You know what I mean? And so since two petitions were actually made at the beginning, I want a clarification. We'll make sure we get it to you in the proper manner in accordance with the ordinance standards. The last thing we have is a special land use for a massage establishment at a small building at Harper and Denton. And that's all I have.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments, discussion from the commissioners? Go ahead.
Yeah, Bruce, going back to with the IACS, I had heard that they were coming, that they were also looking for a special land use.
Through the chair, no, that wouldn't be necessary.
Okay.
Special land use would not be required. It's if it were, it would be a special land use if that use were, you know, original, right? So, but this is an existing use, and with that change to the zoning, then it makes that eliminates that not any nonconformity that's on that site. So by doing that, and that was part of the purpose of my discussion and bringing it forward, or us bringing it forward together, both the administration and the folks from the center, as a zoning change, was not only to facilitate the addition that they want to do, but to have the proper zoning for the use on the property. Let's make it a conforming use. Eliminate the nonconformity. Mm-hmm. Planners, that's your job, is to eliminate nonconformities whenever possible. If you look at the nonconforming section of the zoning ordinance, that is the goal, the stated goal at the beginning of that section, is to, wherever it's reasonable or possible, eliminate nonconforming situations. And so it's as much that. So special land use, no, that would not be necessary. Conditional rezoning, zoning it to B3, and then limiting the use to the use that's on that property. They're asking for the limitation, not us.
I understand, but okay. Weren't we trying to, and I'm trying to get away from conditional rezoning? Wasn't that a goal that we...
In general, it's a goal that I have,
yeah,
from a planning standpoint. Under the state statute, it's something that is part of zoning and planning. It's on the statute, and we have to consider it. It is something that can only be offered to this administration and to the planning department, so it is not something that I would discuss with a developer. It's not something that I would discuss with a property owner, but they, any property owner, has the right under the law to do that. I'm just more of the mindset of, let's steer direction in the proper location with the proper zoning and as much as possible meet the ordinance requirements for those districts. So that's kind of really what I mean when, you know, you need to consider them if they're offered. The township board needs to consider them if they're offered. I think there are more efficient ways of dealing with uses and site planning and that than using just a conditional zoning.
Any other questions, comments? If there are none, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
No oppositions. Meeting is adjourned.